Python is a very very simple, very easy to learn language. It is one of the most simplest language in terms of syntax, but yet it's very powerful. You can build very very complex systems, very complex programs. It is an object-oriented programming language. Its syntax are usually considered as the most elegant one. You'll see why it is thought so. It is a dynamically typed language. That means you don't need to declare any variables explicitly. The variable types are dynamically chosen when you're assigning the values. And also, it is an interpreted language. It's not a compile. It doesn't have a compiler. It is an interpreter. So you don't need to compile the source code and then run it. You just write the code and directly you can run the code. So it's an interpreted style language, and all these features makes it a Python a very versatile and also at the same time very very easy to use language. You can start using Python right away in the Python console. Here are some of the documentation. These are from the original Python documentation. Most of my examples I have taken from this first informal tutorial for beginners. It's an informal tutorial. A more formal and a very comprehensive tutorial, not tutorial, reference is available in the second link. And reference the standard libraries are available in this third link. So to begin with, let's see how to get the Python interpreter. So you can the Python is by default available in most of the popular Linux distributions such as Ubuntu, Fedora, and all. In Mac OS, you can install Python by downloading this package. I'm sure it's easily available in Windows also, but I'm not very good in Windows and I have no experience in that. So I'm not sure how it is done in Windows, but I'm sure it is there. Recently, this another popular package is Anaconda, by which you can install Python, which you can load it from here. Anaconda is not just a Python package; it consists a lot of libraries for data science. So once you install Anaconda, most of the libraries will already come with Anaconda. So you can install have Python by any of these means. And here in this tutorial, I am assuming that all are using some sort of Unix-based OS, which is either some Linux distribution or some maybe Mac OS. As I said, I don't have much experience with Windows, so I'm assuming that you're using some of these OS's. So once you have installed the Python interpreter can be invoked from the terminal by typing Python, and just by entering, you will enter into the Python console. See how we can do that. I'll switch to a terminal here. Okay, so is my terminal visible?
Yeah, please go ahead.
Okay. So I have Python installed in my system already. So if you have Python, you can just type Python and enter. You're already inside the Python console. So you're actually ready to go. You can start, writing your program inside this. Simple, you can do some simple calculation. So let's see some simple calculations first. So you can actually use this Python console as a desktop calculator, a simple desktop calculator. So you can do simple calculations like anything. Okay. It just so the So the answer is the output is printed right next to the input, and the input is characterized by this three greater than sign. So you can do such simple calculations right away in this console. I mean, you can also write a full program inside this, but which is not very, which is not very handy. I mean, you can't, it's difficult to write full programs in this console, right? So programs in a file, and you can run the program by calling the Python interpreter. So I'm quitting this right now. Okay, so I can quit this by inserting Control D. Now you can write a simple Python program. Using any of your text editor. I'm just writing some simple command here. After saving this, I can run this program by calling Python and my program name. It's just printed what I asked it to print. So this is how you run a Python program. Okay. But for this tutorial, I'll be using something called as Jupyter Notebook. So consider Jupyter Notebook as a Python console itself. Okay, it's similar to a Python console, but you can have a lot more other functionalities inside that notebook. Like you can have inline documentation, etc. And it has much more features, and it's very handy when it comes to, when you do analysis, and you can keep your code, you can keep all your figures, all the descriptions. I mean, you can do even write small description about the analysis, and you can keep all these things in the sim in a single application. So Jupyter is very useful in those terms. So you can install Jupyter by pip install, Jupiter. Actually, it's already installed in mine, but if you give this command, it will be installed in your machine also. So pip is the package manager for Python. So Python has a very large, very extensive libraries, packages. So you can install those packages using pip. So I have installed Jupyter. So I will shift to Jupyter. So from here onwards, I'll do the I'll show the examples in the Jupyter notebook. So just remember, it's just similar to typing your program in a file and running it in Python. It's just similar as that. But in notebook, you can directly enter it and you can see the output right away there itself. So that's the only difference. I'll shift to my Jupyter notebook itself. So from your terminal, after installing Jupyter, if you type Jupyter space notebook, Jupyter notebook will open in your default browser. So it basically, the interface will be it will get opened in your web browser itself. So so let's start the I mean let's see starts some looking at some features of the Python. So first thing is how to comment a line in Python program. So the comment, that means it is just used for our information. This the commented line won't be executed by the interpreter. It will be just skipped. So a comment can be comment starts with a hash character. So you can see here, this is a comment, and so this from here to here, this is not a comment, but this is a comment. Okay, so the program will execute this, but will skip this part, and however, this is not a comment because it is enclosed in this double quotes. So when something is enclosed inside a double quote or a single quote, it is considered as a string. So here, this hash means hash itself. So means it's just a string.
We can't so see
if I
sir we so sir we can't I, yeah we can't I, see your can't, screen yeah we can't see your screen means we are it's stuck means on that Python tutorial.
We skipped it first page only.
You can't see my screen. I mean nobody can. We know
first page.
But we shall help I'll help you. I request everyone to mute their mic. Okay, Prajesh, we are in the first page, which is your browser, which shows main features, Python documentation, Python interpreter.
Yeah, well, time itself.
No, it's not scrolling for us.
So basically, so what you're seeing here, in this thing. You can mouse point. You can see my mouse pointer.
Yes, we can see your mouse pointer.
Yeah, so then this thing is a cell in Jupyter Notebook. So a cell is like a it's a console. It's like this is where the Python you can write your Python code. So whatever I if I press shift enter, it will be executed as a Python. These will be executed in Python. So here the first line is a comment. Okay, a comment starts with a hash character. It can start all. Comment can start at a line also, like in the second line. So here to here it's not a comment, and then the comment starts. In this case, this is not a comment because this is inside a double quote. Okay, so when some characters are inside double quotes or a single quotes in Python, it is considered as a string. So here hash means it means hash itself. So let's see how these, when we execute this, what happens. So I executed this. And if I type spam here, you can see the spam variable has a value 1, right? And none of these things got executed. No errors, nothing happened. Here, if I type text, so the text contains this whole characters, right? So now let's see some of the, you can, as I said, you can use this as a desktop calculator. Now let's jump into some simple examples. So you can just type 2 + 2 or any kind of arithmetic inside Python and you can get the results. So if you type 2 + 2, you can get 4. Here you can 50 minus, so this is 50 minus 5 into 6, which is 30, you can get 20 here. And yeah, in this step we can see one something different happen. So all these are integers, but yet the answer came in real or in floating point. So that's because in Python the division is always floating point, in floating point. Even if you do an integer division, the numbers are integers, when you do a division the result will be in floating point. Okay, so yeah, so that's told here. So there is a integer division, or called the floor division, where the decimal part is ignored, only the integer part is retained. So that is called a floor division, and the operand for floor division is this double slash. So if you do this, you can see 17 floor divided by 3 is 5. This operator is for reminder. So if you do this, you can see it's 17 in the 3 is 2. You can get the power of a number by this 2 stars. An equal to sign is used for assigning values to the variable. Okay, so here I am assigning the value to variable width and assigning this value to height, and I'm just calculating this. So if I print this, the answer is 900. Okay. And in Python, if you're trying to use a variable which is not defined, or if you haven't assigned a value to that, it will give an error. So in this particular statement here, you can see that n is not, we haven't given any value to n. So this will, if I execute this, this will give an error. So this n is somewhere defined. So maybe I have to restart this kernel actually. Yeah, so basically it didn't give an error because n somewhere down here n is already defined. So I resetted the this whole page, so now nothing is defined. So here now n is not defined, and the Python gives an error saying that it's a name error, and name n is not defined. So if you see an error like this, it means that you're trying to use a variable which is not defined. Apart from numbers, Python can also deal with strings. Strings are the group of strings are basically a sequence type in Python, sequence of characters. A string can be represented in two ways. It can be either enclosed in single quotes like this, or it can be inside double quotes. So when you're using single quotes, and let's say you want an single quote like this, where apostrophe kind of thing, then you need to escape that using a backslash. Okay, so if you do this, it will print it like this. Inside. So in that case, you don't need to escape it. Or the other way around, if you want a double quote inside as a string, you can use single quotes to enclose the string. Okay. Now there are some special characters like backslash n is for next line. Okay, it means new line. If I assign this whole string here, and if I am printing s here, so if I do this, it just prints.
Prajesh, may I interrupt?
Yeah.
Can you increase the size slightly?
Sure.
Good. Thank you.
Oh, this became too big actually. Okay. Yeah. So you can see this when I just output S, it output it as a row string here. But if I use a print function, the inbuilt print function, and print do a print s, you can see the difference. So you can see that the backslash n is converted to new line when I'm using print s. Okay. But let's say I want something like this. Here there is currently there is a backslash name, but there is backslash n here, which is actually not a new line, right? But if I do a print in this case, it will show it as a new line. But I don't want that. In that case, you can use this. You can convert this, or you can use this as a row string. And to do that, you can append this r here. When you append this r, it means you are telling Python that this is a row string and don't use any special meaning for any of these characters. So if I do this, it prints how I want it. Okay. Now another way to assign strings which spans in multiple lines. You can assign a string which spans through a multiple line by using this triple double quotes, or you can use triple single quotes also. So starting a triple quotes and ending triple quotes. So whatever write inside this, even if there are multiple lines, it will be taken as a single string. And do this, you can see that it prints it the way it is assigned. In string, you can also do addition, or basically string concatenation. And also you can repeat a string by using this multiplication. Okay, so here in this example, so this un will be repeated 3 times, and ium will be, after that ium will be added to it. You can see the output here. So you can see un is repeated 3 times and then ium is added to it. Strings, as I said, it's a sequence type. So in sequence type, you can actually you can subset the sequence. You can basically also index the sequence and get the positional characters at each position. So in this example, this word is equal to Python, and you can get the zeroth position character by doing the name of the variable and then the position, the index inside a square bracket. So this will give you the character in position 0. So you can see it gave p here. So this will give you the character in position 5. And it should be noted that in Python, the indexing starts from 0. So that's why the zeroth position is actually this first position. So here the fifth position is the last one. Yeah, it means actually the sixth number. And here this is, you can also do indexing from the reverse side. So by using negative indexing, so negative one means the last character. Okay, so the fifth position and actually the negative one are the same. Minus two means, similarly, minus two means the second last character. You can also do subsetting or slicing by using this colon. So here the characters from the second position up to fifth excluded. Okay, so this is something different from other languages. If you have used Fortran or C or the languages, so the in Python it is slightly different when it comes to this slicing. The last index is not included. Okay, so this is actually from second to fourth. Okay, so people who are shifting from other languages, this initially they find it slightly difficult to accustom to this feature. So here you can see it as a second to the, which means this from this is second position to the fourth. You can also so if you omit the indexing in the here, the starting index is will start from the beginning, and if you omit the ending index, it will go till the end. Okay, so here it means from the fourth position to the end, and here it means from the starting to the to second position explode. Also you can do the using it, you can also use it in terms of the reverse indexing. So in this it's like from the second last to the end.
Prachish, one I can see a question in the chat. Because it's a hands-on session, better be attempt at address at the time. So I advise the speakers in that case, the participant may speak up, otherwise these questions will not be noticed.
Actually I can't see,
he can't see the chat because he's sharing the screen. So if you have a doubt, please open your mic and speak up.
Hello.
There is one question. For this time, I'll read it for you. The question is, if someone want to type 1, 3, 5, how to write that?
Want to select one.
Somebody's mic is echoing. Is it your device?
Hello.
Yes, but you may please continue. I did not get any feedback from the person who asked the question.
So in so the however the strings are immutable means you cannot change a character of a string. Like if you cannot assign a new, you can access the strings by position, but you cannot assign a value to a string. So if you try to do this, if you try to put a new character to the position zero, at the position zero, it will give an error. Okay, so but this str object does not support item assignment. There is a built-in function called len, basically length. So length will give you the length of the string. So here the length of the string is 6. Len is not only for the string. It can be used for all kind of sequence type data types in Python. And string is one of the sequence type data type. We'll come up across some other few more. And the next data type itself is a sequence type, which is list. So basically, list is Python's most versatile data type to store groups of values. Okay, most of the time we rarely deals with single values. Most of the time we deal with groups of values, and list is the way in which you can group the values in Python. So a list is so you make a list by list is started with a square bracket, and the elements are comma separated, and so the elements can be of different data types. It need not be the same type. So you can have a list with integers, strings, floating points, or any kind of data type. But usually lists are, I mean, it's allowed in Python to have a variable data types inside the list. But in practice, that's not done. So here, is there a question?
Yeah. Actually, I wanted to ask, for all these different kinds of lists and strings and everything, is there a way, if I have a variable?
I'm not clear actually. The voice is very low. Yeah, your voice is very low and not clear.
Is it okay now?
Yeah.
I wanted to ask one question. Like, if this one is a list and you have a string, is there a way by which you can check which class the variable belongs to? Like, whether it's a list or a character or a string or a data frame or something?
Sorry, I'm it's not clear again. So here is an example. So squares is a list of squares here up to 5. So if I execute this, you can see the list here. Similar to the strings, you can do indexing, you can do subsetting, all those things with the list also in the similar fashion. So it gives the value at zeroth position here. This will give the last value. This will give you a new slice of the list starting from the third from the last to the last. Okay. List can also support concatenation. That means you can actually add two lists and make it a bigger list. I mean, which includes all the elements of both the list. So here is a list which we assigned earlier, and here is the new list. So if I do a concatenation, which is done by this addition operator, we'll get a bigger list. Okay. And unlike a string, lists are mutable. That means you can change the values of the list items. Okay, so here are the cubes, and I'm changing the value at the position 3 to 64, and then if I print it, you can see it changed to 64. Yeah, so lists are mutable. Also, there are special methods for list object. So basically, methods are functions which are actually attached to an object. So in Python, everything is an object. Okay, so in Python, all variables, everything is considered as object, and objects can have attributes attached to it, and these attributes can be it can be some property, it can be some values, it can be some functions. Okay, and these functions are called methods. A function which is attached to an object is called as method. So here, list object has a method called append, and this append method actually does what it says. It appends a value to the end of the list. Okay, so if I do this, this value will be appended to the end of this list, and after that, if I do this, this value will be appended after this value, right? So if I execute this, let's see what happens. Yeah, so first it appended this value and then appended this value. Okay, see more of list methods afterwards. Length len, which as I said can also be used over on the list to get the length of the list. So if I do here, can get the length of the list here. It is also possible to have list you can have list of lists. So you can have, I mean, you can have as many, I mean, you can have lists of list and lists of list and lists of list. You can go on making. So here A is a list. N is another list. X is a list which of elements A and N, which are again, which are already lists, right? So, so X of list here. So you can see this is the X list X, and this is the list A here, and the list N here. Okay, so you can have nested list. Yeah, so if you do x0, it will give you the list A, and if you do x0 1, it will give you the value at x0, which is this, and at 1, which means A, right? Okay. Another important thing when it comes to list should remember is, let's say I am doing something like this A equal to B, B equal to A, which means I am assigning A to B, right? So this list, I am assigning this A list A to B. Now let's see what is B here. Okay, so it says B is ABC, a list containing these values. Now, if you have used other languages, if you're Fortran example, if you do this an operation like this, and if you change a value of B, let's say I'm changing the value of the list B position 1 to something else, let's say I'm changing it to D. Okay. Yeah, now it got changed to D. Now let's say what happened to A. A also changed. The item of A, the first item of A also got changed to D. So that means this operation actually is not assigning a copy of values of A to B. Okay, so it's actually aliasing A. So here it's A and B are pointing toward the same list. So B, you're changing A also. So this is something which you have to keep in mind when you're using list in Python. So if you want to, let's say if you want you don't want this kind of a behavior, you want to have a different copy of this, you can do a full slice of A. So now if you do this, I'll run this once more so that it will reset it. So now if I do this, okay, it's ABC. Now if I change A, changed A, and if I type A, it didn't change the value, right? So so when you want a copy of a list, you have to always use this slicing operator. Okay. So let's okay, now let's move towards writing some simple programs in Python. We'll be using more features like loops, if statements, etc. here. So here is a small program which finds what does it do? It finds the Fibonacci series, I think. Yeah. So it's a Fibonacci series. So basically, Fibonacci series is sum of two elements. Defines the next. Hello. Is there a question?
There is echo from someone. Yeah.
Okay. Hello.
Yeah, please go ahead. Rajesh, do you have a two device operating there? Do you have two device open?
Do you open
there? Have two device open there?
No, no.
Okay.
No, I have only one.
Now it seems it's resolved. Please go ahead.
Yeah. Yeah, so here so let's just execute this and then we'll go through what happened. Okay, so here it
two device opening.
Sorry? Hello. So here it printed the Fibonacci series till 10 actually. So what? So there are so many new features which is introduced here. Let's look at one by one. So in this particular line, you can see that there is a multiple assignment. Okay, so here what it does is it assigns 0 to A and it assigns 1 to B. Okay, so this is a multiple assignment. It's a really nice feature available in Python. Next is so you can see a while statement here. Now, so this is a while loop. Okay. So what happens here? And you can see an indentation here, right? So in Python, a code block, a block of a code is represented by indentation. Okay, nothing else. There is no if. End if or while end while or no curly brackets, opening curly brackets and closing curly brackets or anything like that. Everything is just by indentation. So here you can see that the code is indented here. That means this two lines is inside this while block. Okay. So what happens here is so this particular block runs repeatedly until this particular statement is true. Okay. Okay, so the first statement here is to print A, and next statement here is again a multiple assignment, and here what it does is it assigns so when there is an assignment statement, an assignment operator, the things on the right side, that means A plus B happens first. Okay, so then that means for the first iteration, so this will become 1. So B is already 1, so A will become 1, B will also after this assignment. Okay, and then it goes on and on until A is equal to or greater than 10. okay, when a is equal to or greater than 10, this block is stopped, and that's what happening. Okay, so that's why again you can see that's the output printed. And so here this is a less than operator. Similar to this, you have all other operator which are, you know, available, usually available in all the languages, like less than or equal to, less than or greater than or equal to, greater than, equal to, not equal to. All these operators are available. Okay, so you can check for all these operator if you want in the Python tutorial, which I shared the link above. I'm not going to go into details of that. Basically, it's very simple. I've written. We'll directly now go into more control flow tools available in Python, and the most famous would be the if statement. Okay, so all of you must be knowing what is if statement from other programming languages. So it's same in Python also. Only the syntax is slightly different here. So as I said, the code block is determined by indentation. So here the if statement starts with a if keyword, and then a condition, and then a colon, and then the code block is indented here. Okay, so these two are indented here. Then you can have else if. Else if is L if here in Python, and another condition. Okay, and the code block inside, and you can have any number of else if, and then you can have optionally you can have else. Okay, so else and all these elif are actually optional. Optional means it if you want it you can use it. Only if is also possible. So this is a typical if statement in Python. So if I run this, it will execute actually else. Okay, because none of these statements were true. X was not less than zero, X was not equal to zero, X was not equal to one. So this statement got executed, right? Next is for statement. So for statement also is a familiar statement from other languages. But in Python, it is the way it behave is slightly different. In languages like C, for statement is actually an iterator which iterate over a range a series of values, right? I mean, you give a starting value, then you give an increment, and then so the for loop will go on incrementing to the end of the value. In Python, for loop is implemented as to iterate over a list of values. Okay, so let's see an example here. So here is a list words. Okay, it contains three items. Now I can iterate through each item of this list using this for loop. So w in words, and will iterate through this list, and w each time w will get these values, okay? And then I'm printing here, just printing here the item, and then I'm just using a length function to check its length. So if I execute this, you can see the output here. So in case if you want to iterate over a range of values, I mean not a list, you can use the inbuilt function called range here. So if you want to iterate from 0 to 5, you can just use range 5 in the for loop. Okay, so if you do this, you can see that I is from 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. So the range function actually can be used with a single argument like this. So if you give it as with a single argument, it means it will start from 0 until this excluded again. Okay, so it starts from 0, it went up to 4. If you give two arguments, that means it starts from the first argument and goes up to the second argument excluded. Okay, so this will go from 5 to 9. You can see if I do this, it really doesn't print it, it just says range 5 to 10. It didn't print 0 to 4. That's because this range function doesn't actually make a list when it is called. It iterates the values only when it is called in a loop. Okay, so these kind of functions are called iterators in Python. So if you actually want to create a list of values, you can to see this list, you can just do it by using the inbuilt function called list. And if you do this, now you can see that it made it converted this iterator into a list starting from 5 to 9, right? And similarly, if you have three values in range, this is starting, this is ending, and this is the step or increment. So in this case, if you do a list, so this will start from 0 with an increment 3, it will go till 10. Okay, so 2, 3, 6, 9. The range function can also use in the negative values. So here this will go from minus 10 to minus 100 with an increment of minus 30. Okay. So if you want to iterate over a list using its index, you can combine this range function with the length function like this, and you can do the iteration. Okay, you can access the values like this. So if you do this, yeah, so you can access the values using its index. This can also be accomplished in much easier and much elegant way by using inbuilt function enumerate. So what enumerate does is so when you do enumerate over a list, A is a list here, okay? So when you do enumerate over a list, it gives the first item, first element as the index and item. Okay, so here you see the for loop has two variables here. first is I and then the item. Okay, so the first variable it gives as the index and the second variable it gives as the item itself. So enumerate can be used to get the same the same thing you can get it by enumerate. Okay. So this I explained earlier. So if you print range, it just prints range, but you can make it into a list using this list operator. So this is about the for operator for loop in Python. If there is any question, I will just stop for a while and I'll answer the questions. Okay. I think there are
43. Hello.
Sorry.
Hello.
Yeah.
In the line 43.
This one?
Yeah. So you said words. So you said words. This double. But in print, this double. Why print?
Sorry, I'm not. It's not clear.
You said in the words, cat within the words, cat within the for the words, green for the words.
Hello,
Rajesh, can you mute Rajesh, when someone asks?
Can you mute when someone asks?
Help the echo.
Help the echo. Oh, okay.
So I'm asking why cat is printed in this one.
Okay, go ahead with the question, please.
Why in the answer, why cat is printed? Because in the words, W is not there in cat. So why it is printed? Because we have condition given that for W in the words. Hello?
Yeah, we heard your question.
Yeah, hello. I heard understood your question actually. So you are confused with when it is used in if condition. Okay, so there is a different between the in statement when it is used in for and in if. So what you are saying is the in statement when it is in condition, that is if W in words. Okay, that means whether W is in words. In that case, okay, W definitely is not in words. But here it in for when in for in mean, so for W in words means for each of the element in words, and so put that value in W. Okay, that's the meaning of for W in words means. It's different from the if condition. Did I answer your question?
Thanks. Thanks, sir.
Okay. So I'll move to the next the topic here. So break, continue, and else statement for loop here. Okay. Break and continue must be familiar for all of you in if you have used other programming languages. So and it has same meaning in in the other languages. In Fortran, it continue. I think it's cycle, maybe. I think, and break is exit. And here is a demonstration of what here. So what continue does, and mean from here. So here, so when number, so the loop goes from 2 to 10 or 2 to 9 basically, and it checks if num remainder, whether it is divisible by 2. Okay, this statement checks whether it is divisible by 2, and if it is divisible by, print this and continue. So what continue does is just continue the loop, and it doesn't allow the subsequent code block for loop or get it. So it just goes to the next iteration. So whenever the execute continues, it goes to the next iteration. And see, that's what happening here. So whenever it is divisible by 2, it prints this, and then it goes to directly goes to, it doesn't goes to this print statement. It is not satisfied here, this, and then goes to here. Okay, so continues to go to the next iteration of the inner loop. In a similar way, break is for break is used to break the loop. Okay, when break is executed, it breaks the loop. It comes out of the loop. It doesn't go to the next iteration or anything. It just comes out of the loop. So when this condition is met, that is when n is divisible by x, then it breaks. Okay. And apart from break and continue, there is else also for loops, and this is a very very unique feature of Python. I can't see this feature in other popular languages. So for in what else in for loop means is else block is executed when the for loop exhaust. That means if the for loop is not breaked in between, it just exhausts range, else is executed. Okay, so here this is to find number. So prime number is found when when it's not divisible by any of its prior numbers, right? So here this loops, the first loop starts for n, it starts from 2 to 10, and the second inner loop goes from 2 to n. Okay, and it checks for this condition, and this happens any time it gets break, this get broken. Okay, and it is when it is and this for loop is broken with a statement, this else is not else block is not executed. But if it never this never happens for this loop, it get executed, then else is executed. Okay, so this is regarding the uh Next, so if there is any question, I can answer in this session. See if anyone wants to type, they can type also. Okay, I think why else is not indented? Else is actually indented here. This else is for for loop. Okay, and the code block is indented here. And if I need for this for loop, I will put it here. Okay, then I'll move to the next topic, defining functions. Okay, you can write as your own functions in Python by the keyword def. Okay, the keyword def defines a function. So after the keyword, you have to give the function name, and in parentheses you have to give the parameters. Okay, here only one parameter is there, but you can give as many parameters you want. We'll come to the parameters and all later, different types of parameters and all later. So here it's a simple function. Again, this same function which we so an example for Fibonacci series, we are writing that same into a function. Okay, so this is the definition here. Okay, and it ends with a colon. After the code is indented. Okay, so this is the whole function block. Okay, so if you have something here, let's say something like this here, this is not part of this function. Okay, this statement is not part of this function. So a block is always determined by the indentation. So here we are doing the same thing, but now the Fibonacci series is up to n, and n can be, we can input n and get the Fibonacci series up to n. So here it's same in the previous example. Okay, so if I call this function with 10, it will print the Fibonacci series till 10. Okay, so in Python you can also do things like this. Okay, so if here I'm assigning this function object to a new name. Okay, name is f. Okay, so if I do this, and then if I use f of 10, get the same result. It basically f now points to, okay. This function, what it does is just print the value, but Yeah, I can see some questions. Is can we define the function and call it from another program like MATLAB? We done. Whether you can call Python from MATLAB, but you can very tightly integrate C and Fortran from Python. You can write efficient codes in C program, and you can call those program in Python. But I don't know whether you can call Python from MATLAB. Most probably, it's not possible. So yeah, coming to here, so here this function, we are not finding any value here, right? So but in Python, every function return, even if you don't explicitly return a value, every Python function returns some value, and that some value is none. So if I do print of this function, you can see it printed the values. That is because the function itself contains print statement, and is because we are printing what is returned from this function, and which is none. So even if you don't return any value, the by default it will return none. Okay. So every function in there. So one difference is that there are no subroutines in Python. There are only functions. So the function, you can consider the functions which doesn't return or which returns none is like a subroutine. Okay. So here the same function. Now we are returning the value as a list. Okay, it's the same function. The same Fibonacci series, but now we are returning the values as a list. So for that, we are initializing empty list here. So an empty list can be initialized using this square brackets, empty square brackets. And then same procedure, and then you can see the list is populated by using this append method. So each time, rather than printing A, we are actually appending A to the list result. End of the loop, we are returning the values. So if I execute this, if I do print fib2 of 10, so this printed values as a list. Okay, it didn't print any none or anything, it printed the values, and that's because we are returning the values. Okay. So in this particular example, we saw that we've used only one single argument, but as I said, you can have any number of arguments, any arbitrary number of arguments, and there are various ways you can define your arguments. One way is giving the arguments some default values. In this particular definition, you can see there are 1, 2, 3 arguments. Okay, first argument doesn't have any default value. Second argument has a default value, which is 4, and this also has a default value. Okay, now this function does something here, doesn't matter something it does, but see how we can use this default values. So this function, this particular function, can be called with argument or with two arguments, all three arguments, okay? You can have this, you can give input. The first argument definitely is required because it doesn't have a default value. This is a required argument, but these are optional, okay? And either use or not use. You don't give a value for this, it will take the default. Okay, so if I'm defining the function, yeah, so the in statement here, you can see earlier somebody asked about the in statement. So in here there is an in statement with here and which is part of the statement. So the in keyword here behaves differently than in terms of for. So here it means that the whether the value of okay is in this list, okay, and again this particular thing is not a list, this is called tuple. I will come across tuple later. A tuple is similar to list, only thing is tuple is immutable, okay? Tuple, the values of the tuple cannot change, so tuple is immutable. It's just like everything else is like list. So the statements means if a is there, if value of okay is there, that means this will be this is true if okay value is either ye or either yes, okay? Similarly in this case, another feature here, new feature, is due to raise errors in Python, okay? Basically exception. There are many inbuilt exceptions. One of that is value error. So you can raise a value error exception like this. So means it will kill the program, raise this error. Okay. Okay, now let's see how this function can be used by its different arguments. So the function can be just with one argument, and when you give one argument, this is going into this variable, okay, as this argument. And it asks, do you really want to quit if I say yeah? Yeah, this is true because this got and returns. Now, so here it has two arguments, okay? There is two here. This two will go this second argument. So if I execute this, if I say yes, that's the case. Yeah, so if I this and if I type something, then it will say please try again. And you can type in. So retries that to it gave an error. So earlier in this example, we gave all these arguments as positional arguments. The arguments are taken or identified based on their position. That means the first argument goes to the first first you hear to the first argument, and the second value here goes to the second argument. So how this is known as the positional arguments. This is how it is taken. You can have keyword arguments also, where you give the input as keywords. Okay, so for that we'll just have another example here. This is again a function, you can see, and which has here one argument which is not optional, and other three optional arguments with some default value. Okay, so now if I call function with one argument, it goes to voltage. This goes to voltage, prints something. You can do the same thing using keyword. Okay, so you can use the keyword and values explicitly. Okay, so then goes here. You can give multiple value using keyword like this, and the order doesn't matter. Okay, so now here voltage is in the section is in the first voltage in the correct the value. Okay, so when you're using keyword, the order does. But if you're not using keyword, then it will take in terms of the order in which you. Okay. So here all are positional arguments. There is no keyword argument. So in this, it will all be taken in the end. So the first will go, second will go here, third will go here. And here one is positional and the rest is other is keyword. So when you're having a mix of positional and keyword arguments, always the positional argument should come before keyword arguments. That means you cannot have like something like this. Cannot have something like this here, because it cannot be a keyword argument. Once you start a keyword, you can only have keyword arguments. Okay. Now, let's say when you're writing a program, you don't know how much argument or how much keyword argument you will need a priori. Let's say when you're defining the function, at the time of defining the function, you really don't know how much you need an arbitrary number of arguments and keyword arguments in a particular function. Okay, in that case you can test this special argument. This is an argument list and this is keyword argument list. Okay, so what it does is when you call this function, this particular function with some argument, only the first positional argument or a keyword argument with kind as key will go into this particular argument, and rest everything you can give arbitrary number of arguments and keyword arguments, all of those will be converted into a list of arguments and keywords. Okay, so let's see what happens. Let's define this function and look at an example here. If I call and Limburger, the Limburger goes to kind. Okay, so it will print this with the do you have any limber? Okay, so then again kind, here the kind will come. So this particular thing is an argument because there is no word here, so this is an argument, position argument, and this is argument. So these two goes inside arguments and is used here. Okay, for arguments and print arguments. So see, printed furniture, so it's printed here. The keyword arguments are three here. Okay, and see that these keywords are not defined here, and because it's not defined here, all these key will go as dictionary inside this keywords. We'll see what is dictionary later, but for time being, it's similar to list, but with a key which is not integers. So it will go to keywords here, and this can be used like this, and it is printed. So you can see that is printed here. Like this, you can have any number of arguments and any number of keyword arguments, and you can access those inside a function. You don't have to actually write all the. If you don't, there can be cases where you cannot a priori know how many arguments and keyword arguments will be. An example of a real example of such a function can be this simple function where which concatenates or which joins strings. Let's say I want to write a function which will join strings, and it will join for arbitrary number of strings. Okay, I don't want to fix the number of strings, like four. I want it to work for any number of strings. So I can define a function like this, and a concat. Then I can give args with the star. So this is an argument list, and then I can join. I'm using again a method called join, which is a string method. This basically what it does is it joins a list with a delimiter, which is space. Okay, so it joins a list string with a delimiter space. So I defined a function like this here and use it for any arbitrary number of arguments. Okay,